One of the biggest songs of all time, Billie Jean by the King of Pop, Michael Jackson. Let's vocal tune his voice, see how close he was to perfect, and snoop around for some other Easter eggs you may not have heard. Next on Music Surgery with me, Dr. Bob. Regardless of how we may view his personal life, no doubt Michael Jackson had incredible talent, and that's what I want to focus on here. Billie Jean came out when I was in high school and dominated the world. Virtually the whole world knows this song and all its nuances, or do we? Let's put the King of Pop under the scalpel and see how his vocal holds up to today's Melodyne standards and take a look at a few more surprises. All right, so let's listen to the raw files and Michael's vocal.
She was more like a beauty queen from a movie scene. I said, don't mind, but what do you mean? I am the one that could dance on the floor and around. She said, I am the one who would dance on the floor and around.
Okay, cool. Now let's listen to that tuned. Ah, that was tuned. Fooled ya! His tuned vocal is so close to his original untuned vocal that it's basically hard to hear.
Don't mind, but what do you mean? I am the one that could dance on the floor and around.
Tuned.
She was more like a beauty queen from a movie scene. I said, don't mind, but what do you mean? I am the one that could dance on the floor and around.
Okay, one thing you'll see is it's been a little easier for me to do a proper tuning on Michael's vocal than other vocals because his vocal is bone dry, no reverb on it. Let's listen to this vocal for a second by itself, and one thing you'll notice right away that's pretty interesting.
She was more like a beauty queen from a movie scene. I said, don't mind, but what do you mean? I am the one who would dance on the floor and around. She said, I am the one who would dance on the floor and around.
Notice anything different about that vocal that you don't hear in other vocals? He's snapping, and they kept it in.
Beauty queen from a movie scene. I said, don't mind, but what do you mean? I am the one.
Incredible that Quincy or Bruce Swedeen didn't say, hey, Michael, you're snapping on the vocal mic. We can't do that. You know, he's performing. He's performing the song, even though there's no one there to listen to it besides Quincy Jones, Bruce Swedeen, and maybe an assistant engineer. But they let him do his thing. And if he felt more comfortable snapping while singing a vocal, who cares? It sounded great, and it was in time. Let's move down here. Let's listen to the tuned vocal.
She told me her name was Billie Jean, as she caused to sing. Then heavy hair turned with the ice to dream of being the one who would dance on the floor and around.
Untuned.
She told me her name was Billie Jean, as she caused to sing. Then heavy hair turned with the ice to dream of being the one who would dance on the floor and around.
Crazy how close they are. I mean, can barely tell, if any at all. And, I mean, I've got the vocal pretty far out in front of the mix. Now, I did, these are all dry, bone dry vocals that came just how probably they were dubbed off the multi-track. I did put a little compressor, a little tiny little thing on the top there, 6.4, and rolled off some low. The only reason I did that is because I wanted to pop over the track more for this video. It didn't need any of that. Let me go down here to this section so we can hear the tune vocal.
And mother always told me, be careful who you love, and be careful what you do, because the love becomes the truth.
Okay, and now the untuned.
And mother always told me, be careful who you love, and be careful what you do, because the love becomes the truth.
Funny, a few notes a little out.
I am the one.
In my head, I have the melody going, I am the one. Let's see what the main background vocals do.
I am the one.
See, we're used to hearing this chorus with all those background vocals as well. He's a... Who knew? Yeah, I thought I knew this song. I heard it a million times. Virtually indistinguishable, though, from the tune vocal to the untuned vocal. I mean, master singer performing in the studio. Listen to how rocky he gets here, too.
She says I am the one, but the kid is not my
kid is awesome. Here's the untune.
She says I am the...
She, a little flat.
She says I...
I know it doesn't matter. The biggest selling record of all time, or that and the Eagles. So, obviously, it doesn't matter. But just interesting to hear.
She says I am the one, but the kid is not my son. Oh, no.
And a funny punch right here. Listen.
Oh, no.
Sounded like at one point he went, ee-hee-hee, but overdubbed it, no, and we got a little bit of funny punch in right there, because there's no Pro Tools, there's no computers, this is all 2-inch tape.
No,
interesting. So this goes to show you how great a singer and performer he was in the studio. I mean, we all knew that. But now let's hear the chorus with, we have main background vocals here, left, right.
Oh, the Billie Jean's not my love. She's just a girl who...
Unbelievable cluster of cool jazz harmony.
Billie Jean is not my lover.
Billie Jean is not my lover. Here it is with the lead vocal in.
Ooh, could the lie become the truth? Hey, Billie Jean is not my lover. She's just a girl who claims that I...
The da-na-na-na-na, na-na-na-na. That's the money.
Ooh, could the lie become the truth? The Billie Jean is not my lover. She's just a girl who claims that I am the one. But the kid is not my son.
Octaves right there.
But the kid is...
Kid is.
But the kid is not my son. Woo! She says I am the one.
Oh, baby. but the kid is not my son.
Ad libs coming in on both sides.
Says I am the one.
Oh, babe.
But,
oh, babe. Oh, babe. Cool harmonies. So, you're hearing a master singer, and my guess is Quincy Jones had a lot to do with the harmonies in that, because they're so well thought out, almost like horn parts. But who knows? Maybe Michael Jackson did as well. A few other Easter eggs in the song here. There is no guitar in the song other than the hook and the guitar solo. And that is the great David Williams, who I've talked about before on the channel, my favorite rhythm guitar player of all time. He's doubled his part here. Which is interesting because all I've ever heard in my ear, and I thought I paid close attention, is ba-da-ba-ba-dong, ba-da-ba-ba-dong. But as you can tell, like most rhythm guitarists do, they keep the motor going and just mute the notes that they don't want played. And I never knew he did that here. Listen. Incredible. Can you hear that when the music's in? I guess you can. Never noticed it. If you don't know about David Williams, check him out. An amazing rhythm guitarist. I also heard that Michael was so obsessed with these parts that he put on the demo that they had him come in and try to recreate it for the master and never got it the way they wanted, and they flew these parts in from the demo. How they flew them in back then, I don't know. I mean, there was Synclavier and Fairlight when they made Thriller, so maybe they did by then, or maybe they did by tape. Who knows? But incredible part. Another Easter egg I want to show you. This is the drum part that basically, I apologize if I get this name wrong. Ndugu Chancellor, Leon Ndugu Chancellor, incredible player. I think he also played on maybe I Just Can't Stop Loving You later on, Michael Jackson. But basically, they had him play this straight through and all the fills and all the drum fills and cymbal crashes are overdubbed. This is what he played through the whole song. Maybe a few open hi-hats going into the chorus. So we come down here, going into the chorus, and he's plays a fill, an overdub. And then this. So let me play that in context. We have some claps on 2 and 4 in the chorus. Definitely from a drum machine. Don't know which one. Another interesting thing, I'd always heard that Louis Johnson played bass on this song, but it always sounded like a synth to me. So, in the beginning here, we have Bruce Swedeen slating the track, which means saying which take it is. And you can hear that indeed that is an electric bass and Louis Johnson. So here is the part that Louis Johnson played. Which kind of is blowing up on the boom, da 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 da. But they've added this synth on top of it to help pronounce that bass line even more. That's how you get that sound. That's the Billie Jean sound. Very cool part there. That's Michael. Another thing, they had this shaker or cabasa going through the song. It's not a shaker. I think it's a cabasa. I didn't look at the credits. I'm assuming that it's maybe Paulino da Costa. He did a lot of stuff on Michael's records, but who knows? Greg Fillinganes, I think, played the keyboards. This is a CS80. This is the same sound that Toto did on. Sorry, not the same sound, the same synth. Doubled with this CS80. Also, doubled with Michael Jackson singing Ooze, which is interesting. It's a mono track. He's singing with himself, so obviously they bounced this part. I don't know why. And it's mono. Maybe they were trying to save tracks. But there are over 40 tracks here, so they obviously didn't just have one 24-track machine for this mix. They must have locked up at least two. But interesting that they would keep that vocal mono. Maybe they felt that was cool to be in the center because all the synths were outside covering that. Who knows? One more Easter egg. In the song, the only string part that ever comes to my mind is ba-da-da-da-da in the chorus. But come to find out, they don't do that in the first chorus. The cat is not my son. She says I am the one. But the cat is not my son. No, no. Not there. Now, I remember these strings in the verse. Kind of thought it was a synth, but these are actually violas, cello, and violin. And those are real. But listen what we have in the chorus of this song. Gone into a room, hey, the Billie Jean is not my lover. Woo, just a girl who claims that I am the one. But the cat is not my son. She says I am the one, but the cat is not my son. No. Who thought? I mean, in all of my life, I've never heard those parts. I mean, if I go back and listen now, I probably will and hear them in the mix. But I just think that's incredible. I mean, it's so classy and almost sounds like a Beatles-y kind of thing. I'm sure it was probably Quincy that arranged them. It doesn't really matter. It's just so awesome. That's about all the things that I thought. There's one more part here for you jazz fans. This part, where is it? I thought this was a synth. You probably already knew. But this is actually the sax player, Tom Scott, playing, I think they called it a Lyricon, which is kind of a synth saxophone. You know that part.
Careful what you do. Don't go around breaking young girls' hearts. And mother always told me.
Didn't know that was Tom Scott. Anyway, a real treat to hear how close that he sang to perfect. Actually, how much better he sang than perfect. And to really hear these integral arrangements in the strings and the background vocals. I think it's Greg Fillinganes on keys, how tight and locked he is, what they did to accentuate the bass, how they kept the drum fills separate from the groove so they could just concentrate on that groove and get that in a spot which really carries the whole song with the bass part. Truly exceptional recording, arrangement, performance, musicians, all the above.
No doubt, genius pop music from top to bottom. A deep dive into what you get when you have a great song, smart arrangement, world-class musicians, an incredible engineer, and a one-of-a-kind artist. Well, that's it for this week. Make sure to check out the Doctor's Lounge for great samples, stems, and one-on-one help with your song production or mix. Thanks for watching, and until next time, take care of yourselves and each other, and I'll see you the next time the doctor's in.